Blog Talk Radio.
Ah, there it is.
Welcome to Hidden from History. I'm Bill Annett. I'm sitting in today for Russ Letica and my son Kevin, along with Nell Cole, of course, who as producer, director, and total creator of Hidden from History is really always the star of this show.
Oh.
Kevin's lecturing in Toronto today as we speak, just winding up 6 weeks of a film, lecture, and book tour. That's included the UK, Ireland, Europe, and now Eastern Canada. If there's time later, we'll give you an update and talk about three other monumental events that have broken in the last two or three days in Montreal, Ottawa, and Seattle. And Russ would have run today's show a lot better than I can, but he has a huge convention going on in Las Vegas. Russ will be back next week. Today we have two highly unusual guests, Ken Kozarik and John Brown. Ken's in California and John's in Australia. They are a dangerous duo, a tag team who have organized an amazing organization known as GCAC, the Commission into Government and Church Abuse. And let's get right into it. Are they available now? Ken, if you're available, would you lead off and tell us who you are and how you met? And John, just jump in whenever you feel like it. I know the way you guys operate. There's no need for formalities. Ken?
This is Ken.
Well,
I'm on the line.
John, that's you, right?
Yeah, can you hear me? This is Ken.
Oh, that's Ken. Okay. I wasn't sure which one was on because it had your Skype name.
And I wanted
yes,
to make
Ken,
sure John's on.
Fine. I don't see John
You're
yet,
loud
but I'm
and
sure
clear.
He'll be there any second. So you just go ahead with yours, Ken, and then John will jump in when he gets here.
Okay, this is Ken Kozarik in San Diego, California, and I met John 2 years, 2 months ago on, what were we at? YouTube. I have a page up on YouTube and found out about him and found out about abuses, and I'd been watching the Catholic Church and its arrogant ways of telling the people they hurt to go pound sand, and I go, you know, we can't keep doing this. So John, I talked to John. I said, I got these really cool purple T-shirts. I'll send you some. Got him laughing about this and take the anger away from what the Catholic Church is doing to people and try to put some humor into this and awareness. And we have a humorous side. It's kind of funny. We should have a comedy team, I think. But we've got the Catholic Church now. I don't know. I think they're quite worried about people like us, and we're telling it like it is, especially with diplomatic immunity that our governments, 162 countries, have with the Vatican to cover up all the crimes they commit. And all this is coming out in the last 6 months that the public's now going, you guys are absolutely right with what you're saying is wrong with the Catholic Church, and the lifestyle of the males at the Catholic Church is quite odd, and I do not follow their leadership. I question it. I'm still a Catholic. I'm not going to run away. I'm going to stand up to these people, and it's really working. We got a lot of people coming on board like yourself to tell the world that I think Catholic Church is wrong. And we send these T-shirts out to any molested Catholic that wants one for free. We don't even charge them for it.
Now, how did they get in touch with you if they wanted one of the shirts, which, by the way, you can see the shirt on the front of the show page?
Yeah, and you can go to Facebook. Facebook's been very, very kind to the molested Catholic because I posted a molested Catholic page on Facebook. You can go there. You can see my ID card that John has helped us make. We can make our own molested Catholic ID cards with our picture on it. And you can get a hold of me there, and I send you a T-shirt. You can see who we are networked with, the GCAC, people like yourself.
And Ken, you have a website. You
Pardon?
Have a website, too.
There's a website.
You have a website. Hello?
Yeah, are you there?
Yeah, you have a website as well, right?
Yeah, it's called xt3molestedcatholic.com. And that's been very positive and getting people who had no one to talk to, they can talk to us and we will listen to them. And we can help them take action against the people that hurt them. So we've networked with and then organizations like SNAP, getting a lot of people involved with realizing that the lifestyle of the managers at the Catholic Church, it's wrong. Wrong is wrong, Catholic Church.
It's been wrong for 600 years.
And it's got to stop, and it takes one person, then two people, three, four, 500, 1,000, 10,000. We have to stop this crazy culty religion. It's got to be shut off. My goal is to have the molested Catholics take over the Vatican, have an office there, open it up to the needy, the homeless, and educate people and stop this crazy thing of men wearing women's clothes, women's gowns. They can get married. It's okay to do it. I'm also you still there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm also involved with the Roman Catholic University of San Diego, which is 3 miles from my house. The president, Dr. Mary E. Lyons, had a priest come in, I think it was a month and a half ago, to get dialogue going with students and the public about, you know, the Catholic Church's ways, and we've got to start talking about it. There's a Catholic church on that campus called the Immaculata. And there was about 5 priests that showed up with their goofy black Halloween costumes on. And you could just tell they did not want this subject to be discussed. But the president of the university says, it's my job to educate the public. You know, it is what it is. But this dialogue has to start. So I start calling her Rosa Parks. And Rosa Parks was the lady who refused to give up her seat in the 50s, I think, in Mississippi on the bus. And she sat where the white folks normally sat. And it's Rosa Parks all over again. This woman stood up to the Catholic Church, said, we're going to start discussing this on my campus. And the Catholic Church couldn't do anything about it because it's open to the public, this $50,000 per campus. Huh?
What a far cry from Notre Dame, eh?
Well, I could go pick on them next, but Mary has invited me to hang out at the campus. I have a business card that will be ready next week to give to the students, and I'm on the board of directors of University of San Diego, and I want some changes made in regards to this crazy lifestyle these Catholic clergymen lead. I ain't buying into it no more. So I've got.
Well, we've got people, thanks to Kevin's efforts, in Ireland, in Australia, all over the place, in Europe,
all over the world.
In Slovenia, on the continent, Denmark, Germany, that are saying the same things that you're saying. And last September, there was a demonstration in London at the time of the Pope's visit.
Yes.
20,000 people marched in that demonstration on the simple issue of whether or not the Pope was immune from arrest or culpability.
It's called diplomatic immunity. And for some strange reason, that man is above you and I can't figure out why, but he can fall just like the rest of us. If you remember, there used to be a Berlin Wall. Did you ever hear of that?
Hello.
You still there?
We hear you, John.
Ah, thanks.
We hear you, John. There used to be a Berlin Wall. Does everybody agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay. Did it used to rule the world with fear?
Exactly.
Okay. Well, the Berlin Wall's gone, isn't it? And the Vatican, goodbye, Vatican. You're going down.
It's like Bill Maher says, I have nothing against the Pope. He puts his dress on like every other guy, one leg at a time.
Yeah. So we got John. He's got to kick his 2 cents in because everybody loves John because he's got that Australian accent. The women go nuts over him.
Okay, John, let's hear from you.
Let's hear from me. No, I can agree with just about everything that Ken's had to say. I haven't heard everything yet, by the way. I've had a little trouble getting in this morning. Definitely agree that these people are a moral danger to society. And given what has taken place in the last 10 years, there's, in my opinion, anybody who remains within that system, it has to be now classed as being complicit, because the evidence is just insurmountable and undeniable. So that's where I come from in that regard. I think they're a moral danger to society. They're a moral peril to every child who exists on the planet.
And the evidence is there.
The evidence is there. We're simply not given a platform to present that evidence in a fair and equal platform. And that's what I think. That's why I admire what Kevin is doing so much. And that lies behind the motivations of almost all people that I've had contact with. They've been denied their opportunity. Many of them are denied their opportunity because they no longer follow the Catholic faith or the Christian faith. And in a country like Australia, that is going to preclude you very clearly and very quickly from equality before the law.
Identical in Canada.
Yes. So we get to live in the results of 100+ years, you guys a few years longer, of living in a Christian country. It's broken, it's corrupt from top to bottom. It's got hordes of psychologically affected followers, and they are a danger to people. So they're very much a danger to children as well. As I said, a moral peril, and I don't think there's any form of corruption that is worse or possible.
John, you're mm-hmm. breaking up a bit, I think. Are you on Skype or regular phone?
No, I'm Skype.
Yeah, it does that sometimes, but it normally clears itself up. So
we'll
just kind of ride through it and see what happens.
That's just my sentiments about it. It's not only is it corrupt, it has corrupted our political systems and our legal systems, our law enforcement. The example of that is very, very blatant in Ireland, where the depth of complicity with the Irish police. This has been documented down. Crimes have been found in commission after commission, investigation after investigation. These are horrendous crimes that are crimes against humanity, and yet we have governments, both federal and state, who have yet to act on clear evidence of crimes.
They covered up for the Catholic Church, 162 countries, diplomatic immunity agreement to let them do whatever they want to do.
They do have immunity. One of the concerns is and it's been raised here and denied by the government. Yet we get, on the other hand, a statement from the Vatican in this regard. The Vatican says that it has a memorandum of understanding or a concordat with more than 160 countries around the world. And yet when the Australian government was asked about it, they said no, they didn't have one. So government doesn't know, hasn't quite got its story right.
It's cover up by judges, district attorneys, and
yes.
they're paid very handsome pensions to go along with this game, and they brag about their pension. I got out of a traffic ticket in January because I made the cop write molested Catholic on the ticket, and I went to court to pay the ticket because they didn't send me the summons to pay it, so you still have to show up. The cop didn't turn the ticket in because he didn't want to address molested Catholic / diplomatic immunity in the courtroom. He's like, you're crazy. I'm not going to talk about this there. This is a little thing we got going that's just between the cops and the clergy. So district attorneys have boyfriend Catholic clergy that they sleep with.
Yes. Yes. This is very, very similar to my experience here in Australia, that police don't investigate the Catholic Church.
Nope.
Because most of the complaints are of sexual abuse by their clergy. They're very, very difficult crimes to bring evidence, direct evidence or supporting evidence. And so if you ignore the medical evidence, then you've got no crime. When you have a system that has built in forgiveness or the opportunity to disavow itself of its responsibilities and its liabilities.
No accountability.
Well, that's exactly what the Catholic system does. It allows you to, and I think it was Richard Dawkins who explained that very, very well, that it takes away the conscious part of a crime. You can commit a crime within the secular world, and you can be forgiven for that crime in the Catholic world.
And there's no documentation of any crime at any level.
There's no record. So,
because the Catholic world, attributes the crimes of this kind, doesn't call them crime. They're sins, and therefore anything can be absolved in the confessional.
Exactly.
And then you move the priest to another city where nobody knows of his past.
Right.
When you have a magistrate, a judge, and a Supreme Court judge who has been raised since childhood with that understanding there, and that's an understanding that they've had indoctrinated into them or inculcated into their thoughts and their mind by the time they're 3 and 4 years of age, the system is set. And regardless of the education in law and regardless of the attempts to apply the law, a person who is affected psychologically like that must give allowance to his priest and his fellow Catholics and Christians, because his first law is to his church and his religion. So it's quite easy to give the absolute minimum, and this is part of the minimization process that survivors talk about. Yet, it's the classic example of that was recently with Julian Assange. Here in Australia, when he was in the news there, the Australian government sent its attorneys to work to plough their way through the law book to try and find a law that they could apply in this circumstance. So they were quite studious in doing that. However, when it comes down to looking through the law books for possible crimes occurring in regards to Catholic clergy, and not only Catholic clergy, this also applies to Catholic business people very, very strongly. In fact, probably far stronger. Just your everyday, quote, good Catholic. They are, and they have the opportunity of being prejudged and pre-forgiven by the person who's now going to sit in judgment of you and of a member of the clergy. The system is biased.
Which is canon law.
It's derived from cannabis in part, yes.
And canon law controls all laws.
It is psychological terrorism on the country. It's a cult that has established a means to usurp the power and authority of the legitimate governments of those countries where they exist. Now, that's the outcome of it. I don't know whether that's been by design, but that is the result of what we have of 100 plus years of Catholicism in a so-called democracy.
Back to the fact that the Catholic Church is the successor to the Roman Empire.
Yes.
And the marriage of power and religion is all
yes.
that it took.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes.
John, if I could just interrupt here, it seems to me we have a different sort of set of circumstances. The work that Kevin's been doing, you know, over the last 20 years in Canada, you guys are almost totally focused on the Catholic Church. This, of course, is true. This is true, of course, in Canada.
It's a much, much wider issue.
Kev's been involved with, from the beginning, the rights of indigenous people and the abuses of all three major religions, Christian religions in Canada. That is the Catholic Church, the
yes.
Anglican Church, the Church of England,
United.
And the Protestant Church is represented by the United Church of Canada.
Right.
And so I'm not sure about the situation in Australia as far as the legal system is concerned. In Canada, while we brag about being, we act as if we're a republic or a democracy, but in actual fact, we're still a colony, although everybody
yes,
pretends to forget about it. So we have British colonial law to deal with, whereby any lawyer in Canada is an officer of the Crown,
that's
whatever
right.
the hell that means. But in fact, it means you do what the court tells you to do. Otherwise, my son Kevin would long since have been able to sue the United Church of Canada for illegal discharge and all sorts of stuff.
Right? Yes.
But it's absolutely hopeless. There's not a lawyer in Canada that would touch his case with a 10-foot pole.
It's tantamount to
abdicating any idea of having a future career to do such a thing.
It's treasonous in any other circumstance and would be an outrage. The same, the history is a little bit different here in Australia. The land was, they didn't have the battle for land as they did in Canada. They dealt with that by declaring the place void of people. They declared terra nullius. And that meant that there was nobody here when they came. So England arrived and there were a healthy population of Aboriginal people here with many, many nations and had been here for 40 to 60,000 years. And in their supremacy, they declared that there was no one here. So therefore, they took possession of the land.
Fortunately, the Catholic Church had announced in the 14th century that any indigenous people in the world were less than human, and therefore you could do whatever the hell you wanted with them.
That's the Catholic Church.
And they were given the right to take possession of all the lands and all the goods of the land.
Right.
And just as they did with King Ferdinand, and this was the papal bull, gave authority to King Ferdinand of Spain, I think it was, to take possession of land, and they gave them authority to operate the commerce of the land. And this, when you look at what has happened in both, or more than just Australia, but Australia, Canada, Commonwealth countries, you will find that the Constitution is focused and centres around commerce and industry, and the Parliament focuses around commerce and industry, and in almost all cases, following that papal bull and from what we understand of the memorandum or of understanding or concordat, dealings of the people, the individuals, the human beings, is guided back to the church systems. This is why governments shop this type of work out as an extension of government services. Now, they continue to shop this out to organizations that have been involved in genocides and other atrocities around the world. And governments are fully aware of the involvement of this organization in those genocides, yet they continue to deal and trade with them.
And cover up the crime.
Well, they abuse their rights and their obligations of the people who elected them. And they're not honest with them. And they, therefore, the government, when it colludes in this way, it has to turn the same form of exploitation that the church applies to people onto the population through the government and political and legal systems. And that's the type of structure that we have in operation. Now, the application of common law, believe it or not, in my opinion, is an area that we need to investigate much further. But before that, there is a proper legal process, and there is a number. Or given the platform, we believe we have insurmountable evidence. And when I say evidence, the evidence of that is in those people who've had direct experience. These are the survivors of abuse. And those are the people who are silenced the most in society. Now, the church deals with this in a particular way, or a number of ways, but primarily in the way of the setup of what's referred to here as the Melbourne process. And that is, it sets up independent commissions with independent review panels and the like, and these are set to quickly process and sign up people for a very, very small amount of money. To give you an example, here in Australia, in Melbourne, the Melbourne process, people can get up to, I think, $75,000 today. Most of them will receive less than half of that. Whereas if you go to a good lawyer who does represent you squarely, the run-of-the-mill sign-up and finish is around $200,000. If you take it to court and you get a settlement on the doorsteps of the court, the settlement can be around $2 million. The thing is that they will settle. They don't want it in court. And that's if people take them to court, because that's the only avenues that they have. Money is not a problem to them. When you have resources in Australia of over $100 billion, a couple of million is nothing to you. And if you know that you have a guaranteed income from the quite good work that you do for your government, for the government of the country, I'm not sure, around $35 billion a year of Australian taxpayers' money is diverted away from our government into these religious organisations. So they cheat the population out of their money, and they make their children available for the sexual exploitation of their priests. There's nothing more cult-like than that possible. And that's what we've got. That's what we're calling society today. That's what we're calling democracy. And we live in nothing remotely like democracy. So one of the other things I was wanting to add is that around the world we've found very, very similar structures, not only with the commission set up by the church, but in the support structures that supposedly develop around these locations where they've been forced into making or taking some sort of actions. These are generally victim support groups. Most of these seem to be a fast track through the processes to get a very, very minimal amount of money as a settlement and a confidentiality agreement. There's a very, very strong pull to have you return back to your the abuse of religion. Very, very strong pull there on people. And the reason for that is that if they can pull the survivor back into the church, then all they do is ask for forgiveness from them. Once forgiveness is provided...
Right, and they make money off of the healing of them.
The psychiatrist
gets all the funding.
Yeah, the psychiatrist makes money. The Catholic psychiatrist.
Historically, it's called indulgence.
Yeah.
Yep. They simply do not know what healing is. This is the most challenging question both the church and survivor groups fail to answer.
John and I have defined healing.
You what ask them.
We define healing
when the white people feel better. It's when the white people feel better.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Our T-shirt's the best healing thing you could ever put on your body.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Our T-shirt works better than those silk robes that those flamers use at the Vatican.
For those days when you're really cranked off with the world, there's nothing more empowering. There's nothing more empowering to put that shirt on and go to the local mall and stand at the top of an escalator and people just streaming up and you stand there and make like you're looking for somebody. You've got a captive audience of thousands of people an hour. If you want to see guilt, if you want to feel equal and empowered, then I strongly recommend. If I get down in there, I put my shirt on and I head into town.
It's something like Kevin used to say when some of these native survivors, he'd... Who's talking?
Somebody's echoing, and I don't know exactly who yet.
Not me.
Okay, let me try again. I'm getting some sort of feedback.
Yes, I am.
But what you're talking about wearing the T-shirt reminds me of some of the stories Kev used to tell when they'd hold a demonstration at the Roman Catholic Cathedral in Vancouver, and these native survivors that would go with them. Some of these guys were so traumatized that they'd look at a cross or they'd look at a priest and they'd get violent, physically ill. And they found that once they had attended one of these demonstrations and appeared in the nave of the cathedral,
yes,
they suddenly felt good about themselves. They felt good about everything. And that's what I describe as healing.
That is part of healing. It's definitely part of healing. Part of healing, because part of the process is to keep you repressed and down and not give you a voice. By wearing this shirt, it gives you a voice. I get an amazing number of nice people stop and talk to you. You can see them come up the escalator and you can see them break out into a beautiful smile and they'll give you a nod and they'll stop and have a chat and they are very, very supportive. And most of them that you find that way have taken the time to educate themselves on this beyond the fact that God did it or God was the answer or look at all the good work we do.
I wore mine to Christmas Eve Mass this last Christmas and a couple older retired ladies came up and hugged me and they said stick it to them. I go, oh, what a cool Christmas present.
Ken, what was the name of that restaurant that asked you to take your shirt off?
Yeah.
Ken?
What's that?
What was the name of the restaurant that you went to for a party and they asked you to take your shirt off?
Oh, Olive Garden is a huge chain of restaurants in the United States that has Italian food, and I wore my shirt in there just because, you know, it's Italian. And the manager came up to me and she said, "Would you please take your shirt off?" And I said,
"Oh,
I ain't taking no T-shirt off, lady. It is what it is." And I ended up calling corporate, and I have their apology on my answering machine if you want to hear it. I can play it right now. It's an apology.
I hate the Olive Garden.
The manageress hopped on an aircraft in Florida to fly to San Diego to undertake a re-education course and to introduce that re-education course across the organization. Now, that was done...
That wouldn't be Daytona Beach, Florida, by any chance, because we have an Olive Garden here, and I avoid the place. I can't stand it.
Yeah, we definitely love to hear it.
Well, they can't stand it
play
either.
Again?
The point of it
hey,
is...
Ken, can you play it?
Yeah, let me see if I can get it. And then it's, you know, I've been going through life as a shunned, molested Catholic, and I'm left-handed. It just doesn't get any worse. I've just been shunned by all.
No shirts, no service.
Yeah. What Ken is talking about is the humiliation that is applied onto children through the Catholic education system.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is psychologically harmful. It's known to be psychologically harmful. And entire generations have been brought up. And those people who in that known abusive, psychologically harmful environment, all right, there's no denying that. Now, people who have gone through that and come out the other side of it and claim themselves to be good Catholics turn around and say that they had a wonderful experience in that same environment. Now, the two positions can't stand, naturally. So they must either deny the survivor or victims of abuse, those who are speaking out, or they must support those who are supporting the church line. So it's a very, very strong line of demarcation there. So firstly,
well,
if you speak out...
Well, what difference does it make if one person had a great experience and the other one was molested? What does the two have to do with anything?
They
don't. To me, it's like, well, sorry, it sucked for you, but I was having a great time. Makes no
That's
sense.
That's exactly
to me.
Right. It's not a relevant point. It's a denial, an attempt at denying the abuse occurred in other people, in its attempt
right.
to minimalize it. Then you move to the few bad apples scenario. Where we're going.
Which you love, right?
I love the scenario. All good Catholics know what the few bad apples scenario is, and that is
right.
that it was only a few pedophile priests who were able to infiltrate the church, and once we've got those out, it'll all be back to down on their knees singing praise in the churches, whilst other quite good Catholics, people educated through a psychologically harmful system for their entire life, are allowed to continue to sexually and emotionally exploit children and women through the use of their religion, and to be given a tax exemption to do it, and to be afforded every benefit of society.
You know, this is one of the most dangerous, the biggest obstacles to be overcome in the United States here. A few bad apples nonsense. There's a very powerful Catholic Men's Association here in the States. I can't remember the exact title, but it doesn't matter. And they are apologists for the whole business. And
yes.
This is what they say. Well, yes, there's a few of these perverted priests And if I could encounter them myself, I'd punch them out, you know.
Sure.
But it's,
sure.
The whole thing has been exaggerated, and there aren't that many. And I got this primarily, well, I saw this jerk on television, but also I have a neighbor who was a priest, and he saw this whole thing about 10 years ago, and he just up and quit, you
yes.
know, turned his back
the,
on.
The important thing to realize about that is that that person is a danger, a sexual danger to children.
Absolutely.
Now, survivors, and they are a serious danger to the welfare and the well-being of survivors, those who have declared and spoken out. They are, the proper definition for it is psychopaths. These people are kleptoparasites, in fact, in my opinion. They take the food out of people's mouths. People who, in the face of the evidence, still maintain that just a few bad apples, and we'll clear those out, are
right.
clearly a danger. They are clearly in denial of the facts.
Correct.
And the facts are that millions of people around the world have been sexually abused by clergy,
right.
and million upon million have been psychologically harmed by...
There's another very dangerous element, and looking at Canada, I'm a recovering Canadian living in Florida, but looking at the 30 million people in Canada, and particularly, I have a sister-in-law who's a wonderful person. When Kevin's in her city, she shows up for all his lectures, and she thinks he's doing a marvelous thing, and she's yep. off to church again every Sunday morning, and she's in total
yep.
denial that
yep.
any organization to which she has devoted 70 years of her life can do anything
yep.
wrong.
That's right.
It's just
That's
incredible,
right.
and this denial and this indifference in 30 million Canadians just constantly amazes me.
Yes.
John, you got to tell everybody about when you interviewed my mother.
Oh.
John, I mean, I had to have John do this because he pulled it off perfectly. He got my mother to tell him why I was taken out of Catholic school because she wouldn't talk to me. She wanted me institutionalized.
Yes.
And
yes,
John got it all recorded. My mother finally said, hey, I need to pull him out of the school. The nuns were beating the shit out of him.
Yes. Okay. And, well...
My own mother thought I was nuts.
Yes.
I understand this. I know I am a jam tart example compared with you guys, but I too experienced abuse by a priest 65 years ago in the little prairie town in Canada where I grew up. I served as at the age of 16. As the chauffeur for this priest, he loved to hire little Protestant boys because he had a country parish, you see. And so I served as his chauffeur, and I drove him around. And it involved staying overnight in another place and sharing a bed with this guy, see.
Yes,
in the middle of the night, he makes a pass at me, and I pretended to be asleep, and I gave him an elbow in the ribs. And he sort of grunted and turned away, and that was it. But, I mean,
yeah.
I would never then have reported him to my father because
no.
this guy was a pillar of the little community we lived in,
yes.
and
yes.
my father would probably have horsewhipped me or something, you know.
Yep.
So I never reported it to anybody until just now.
No documentation.
That's the culture we grew up in.
Yes.
Yep. And our parents
you were less than any priest, no matter how horrible their crime. They were still above you as a human being.
They were above all laws. They were above all laws.
Yes, this goes back to what I was saying. They are above all laws. That's pretty amazing, Bill, to make that statement here. And I can back up your statement that you would have likely been horsewhipped because my father father was good at two things. He was a crack shot with a rifle, and he was an expert with a whip. He would do shows with a whip.
Oh, Lordy.
Wow.
When you're an 8-year old.
I made the right decision in not telling my father.
Yeah.
Well, you just documented it, though.
Yes, you did. I stood by.
I'm officially a survivor.
Yep.
Yes, you are.
You need a T-shirt. It's Catholic purple, John, and what? Greedy gold.
It's Ponzi purple, the color.
Be a color. We're quite stylish Catholic.
Ponzi purple and greedy gold.
Well, I've only been in a church, a Protestant church, twice since my childhood, and I've been married twice, and that's the two occasions. But I'm cramming for my finals right now, so I suppose I should start going to church.
If you really want to see, if it is an experience to go into a church, particularly when there's some sort of ceremony involving children, and it's frightening to see how that manipulation is done. But I wanted to go on and say that there's a very strong line that divides those who believe in the Catholic come Christian faith and gods and those who no longer believe. Now, of those millions sexually abused by clergy, in order for them to survive, they've had to step away from that which has abused them, and that was their religion. So more than 50%, and we feel the figure is up around 70% of survivors of sexual abuse at the hands of Catholic clergy who would declare themselves to be agnostic or atheist. Now, these are people who Catholics have been taught to fear. Not only fear, but also to hate.
Yep.
And these are the people who are repeatedly refused assistance through both government systems, because mm-hmm. these governments are managed and controlled and run by Christian organizations. They're paid to do it by our government. So it's a manner or a method that's employed to block proper process for those people who do not conform, do not believe in the Catholic system and Catholic methods of forgiveness, etc., once again. So that's the result, as I said, of our 100-plus years of society, and that's what we face today.
John, I was in the process of asking you a question time ago, and I got involved in, I was cut off and I had to redial in and so on, but what I was asking, I had heard that in Australia, the Attorney General is free to segue between, let's say, your Australian law, whatever it is, and canon law. At his discretion. Is that correct?
Not as far as I'm aware.
John. That makes sense.
The only body I'm aware that is capable of doing that and does that is one of these so-called independent commissions set up by the church to investigate sexual crimes within the church.
Mm-hmm.
That's
a foregone conclusion.
That's right. They generally hire a high-ranking lawyer, and they're given a commission, and purportedly they operate under the law. But they also have an obligation to operate under the law of the organization which sets them up and pays them, and that's the Catholic Church, and that is canon law. And this was highlighted by statements made by the commissioner in Melbourne, a very, very corrupt commissioner by the name of Peter O'Cahan, who heads the so-called independent commission into sexual abuse in Melbourne. and he made a statement to a survivor that his commission gave him privileges above the law. So in the middle of what we think we're dealing with, something as a legal system, this organization can flip at will into canon law and apply that to an individual or not apply it to an individual. So this is the, I forget the word, of mental reservation system and process. There's no possibility of a win against a system that is as duplicitous as that and as deceptive as that. I wonder if others have experienced that.
Well, of course, that's exactly what the Vatican is doing as we speak. They're creating their own canonical law system.
Yes.
The Vatican is a laboratory, and every one of us is an experiment.
I'm becoming more and more convinced that the most progress is going to be made, let's say, as between Ireland, Canada, Australia, and the United States. I think the way is a lot clearer in the United States than any of the others of us who are sort of hampered by colonial tradition and that sort of BS. And great strides are being made here in the States. I mean, this guy, Jeff Anderson in Wisconsin, has pretty well established it with the Supreme Court.
Yes.
The Pope is not infallible and is, in fact, suable.
We brought it to the college campus at USD, and the president says, we should discuss this. She could have said,
story.
No, get off my campus.
Ken went to the San Diego campus, which is a law university, and they held their first meeting, open meeting, in regards to the issue of sexual abuse by Catholic clergy. And it's now open for discussion at that university. And that's been Ken's work, and that's through Ken's emails, and his wearing a T-shirt around San Diego has enabled that. That sort of thing can be got up in just about any country. It simply takes two or three people working together. The same as turning over the Olive Garden. That was simply done through a phone call and a couple of emails.
Here's the
John, best thing. John, before you came on, Ken was telling us about USC, and I made the remark that it's a refreshing change from the situation, let's say, at Notre Dame.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to break in, if you don't mind, and do a little politicking here. But Ken, do you suppose Kevin's just completing a Canadian tour following his European tour, and starting about September after he gets back from his next trip to Europe, we're going to get our heads together and organize an American lecture tour. Do you suppose it would be possible for Kev to lecture at San Diego, USC?
150%, yes.
Yes.
Well, I'd love to get in touch with you on this, and I'll get the particulars from Nell, and I'll follow it up. But that would be marvelous. He has lectured at Berkeley, but he's never been anywhere else in California, to my knowledge.
Let's do it at a Catholic college, at a Catholic campus, with a Catholic church on the property.
Absolutely.
And I'll have priests there. Hey, I'll have priests there with their black Halloween costumes on.
He'll even wear a T-shirt. I will guarantee Kevin will be game for a T-shirt.
And
if you don't mind, he usually wears his clerical collar, but he can wear it on top of the T-shirt.
We ain't wearing no fucking collars. Fuck that collar.
Well, they're good Catholic collars.
That clerical collar gets them a lot of mileage in Ireland.
Oh, I imagine it would. I imagine it would. I did the clerical collar many, many years ago as a bit of a joke. I used to drive safari tours, and I did one of those in a little place in outback Queensland.
Well, let me tell you another little joke out of school here, but Kevin was recently in Manchester in England, and it was St. Patrick's Day, and apparently there's a huge contingent of Irish people in Manchester, you see. And so he was invited to this pub for St. Patrick's Day, and he noticed that all the Irish guys were up at the bar doing nothing but drinking, and all the women are sitting around in the pub and dancing with each other. And he's wearing his clerical collar, and that all these women were putting the move on him, and he was dancing his feet off, you know, and all these other guys were up at the bar drinking.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it shows you the power of a clerical collar.
Yes. Oh,
yeah. Yeah. I got to see Kevin dancing, and I got to think about that.
Yeah, right.
No.
But that's a good idea, Ken. We'll follow up on that.
So much that can be done in the way of resistance to them. So,
and Jeff and I are doing it as a comedy team. We're good at we laugh as we do it because we can't believe we're getting away with it.
I can't either.
Even XT3 Melissa Catholics, we made a legal firm back off when they tried to threaten us.
Yes.
Ken, have you seen Bill Maher's series? Of short video takes about how religion never did any harm.
Bill, that's
Nell
an interesting thing. That's an interesting thing that Ken has raised there in regards the XT3 Molested Catholics website. It was an interesting little exercise that we set up the website. And we began sending out emails using all the appearance of the original XT3 website, which was set up by the Melbourne, or the Australian Bishop, George Pell. Now, we simply took it on ourselves to make use of their graphics and their structure, and we did that. Knowing that the Pope had said that all effort and resources should be provided to survivors. So these are church resources. So we simply made use of those church resources. And Ken's Catholic. I'm Catholic. They won't release me. So I'm just using the resources of my church to help survivors. Now, that landed us with a legal threat. The documents there on the homepage of the XT3 website. I'm now on my fifth or sixth, I think, legal threat from church lawyers.
Interesting.
None of them go anywhere. None of them go anywhere.
Well, what we did is we took the letter they sent us. It's two pages, and I go, John, let's make a web page out of the cease and desist order from the legal firm.
Yes, and.
Embarrassed a lot of people with that one.
Not only that.
You know, this is very interesting because
the lawyers never thought we'd share the knowledge with the world. And I said, John, we're going to tell everybody how we're going to heal. We're going to use the information.
We immediately published it. And not only did we immediately publish it, but we had a number of people who started to email the law firm.
And it said confidential in the letter, but I wasn't quite sure what that word meant.
So we sent it around the world.
I'm left-handed. I'm not real smart.
We had people emailing them from around the world, and they were attacked in those emails in a manner. We know that we've cost at least one lawyer his job. And we also have pretty good information that one resigned because they'd never been challenged.
150-year-old firm who thought they were above us.
Mm-hmm.
And we're just two molested Catholics been shunned and picked on, and we put a 150-year-old legal firm in their place.
Now
what would y'all recommend to people who are trying to find a voice and they're being shunned by everybody? How would you recommend they take back control?
They need to start talking to us so we can build their confidence level up and get them a T-shirt.
So it all begins with a T-shirt.
Our major problem in Canada and in the States is breaking through to the mainstream media. We can't buy a headline. The situation in Ireland broke about 6-9 months ago.
Correct.
And we had headlines all over the eastern states. I mean, Kevin, in 20 years, talking about little kids with brown faces, could never buy a headline. And suddenly, here's the situation in Ireland because the little kids have white faces. And an interviewer on 60 Minutes said to Kevin, you know, we're going to have to figure out a different angle here because anytime we run anything on natives, our viewership goes to zero.
Yes.
So this is really our big problem.
Oprah's even picked up on this. She had one of our friends in San Diego, actually. He's on their webpage. He was on TV. 200 men spoke up about what happened to them on the Oprah show here in December.
Oh, I saw that.
Well, I'd hate to tell you the number of times I've tried to get Oprah's attention.
Bill, I believe that the only way that we will get acknowledgement of this as an issue into the press and to the parliament, and that's when we get 10, 15, 20 survivors together. We can give them all a shirt if they want a shirt. That's not a problem.
Yeah, I got the money to finance the shirt.
Yep. We stand on the steps of Parliament.
The T-shirts
You know what happens in our Parliament in Ottawa? 15,000 payroll Indians show up giving a big written apology to the Minister of Indian Affairs, who stands on the steps of the House of Commons and blubbers as he accepts this apology. And it only costs the government $1 million or so to haul all these establishment Indians to Ottawa. That's what you're up against.
Mm-hmm. I think...
We don't have the budget.
No, we don't have the budget. One of the things I've noticed, I've been dealing with Forgotten Australians and a number of other groups, I suppose you could call them, that have been identified, Lost Innocents and the like. And one of the difficulties we have has been the separation of these groups or into named entities, such as Forgotten Australians, and you've probably got them in Canada. They've been issued with an apology. It might be for the Aboriginal stolen generations, etc. All of these things are a part of the problem of childhood abuse. As I said earlier, these people are a social menace and pariah on society and society's children. All of these things come under the heading of child abuse, and it's not going to be until survivors of clergy abuse and quite probably native peoples come together under a single banner. And I feel that child abuse is going to be the right banner for that. And I think it's the banner that I can imagine if we're on the steps of Parliament with the shirts on, but the placard would say child abuse. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah. That's the thing is they hide within their own little groups, and that way people don't really understand how globally affected it is of all the children. You put little labels on it, and it seems like it's only over there. But these people travel all over the world. It's all intertwined. So what happens in Ireland directly affects you no matter where you are.
Yes, it is.
It's all in mind.
I have the growing conviction, however, that the only way we make a change is forget the contemporary stuff, forget the compensation, forget what's going on right now and all the victims of six generations of abuse, and start trying to re-educate the kids, you know, and look at the history. I don't know about Australia, but the history of Canada and the history of the United States that's taught in our schools is just a pack of bloody lies.
Yes, it is. It's appalling.
Right.
Exactly the same here. If you were one thing, I'm an atheist, and I'm an outspoken survivor of Catholic clergy sexual abuse. So that's going to put me very much on the lower end of the social scale here, because you name the problems, I suppose.
And the clergy lifestyle, they have to be married. No more of these men with the silk gowns on. The silk gowns gotta go.
Yeah. The only thing that's missing from my life is the fact that I'm not colored. I happen to be white, the same as this racist supremacist organization that we live under. And that's our governments and our good Catholic Church in there. The history of the Aboriginal people here in Australia is just absolutely appalling. And,
yes,
and it makes me weep to hear of the history, and not only hear of the history, but meet people who have been directly affected by these abuses, and they get to be dealt with by people who are unable to see the crimes in this because they identify them, as you said, as the sin.
They're just apples.
And things are forgivable. All right. So if you can't find a crime, but you can find a sin, therefore it can be forgiven. Therefore, there is no crime. It's very, very sick thinking.
Plus, the Vatican financed and orchestrated the Holocaust.
Yeah.
But it's not going to be until there is civil disobedience or survivors come together from many disciplines and come together and challenge our governments to
well, listen, we're in a transformational world. It's happening in Africa, it's happening in the Middle East, it's happening in England, in the Midlands. There was a case the other day Kevin was telling me about, where 600 people went into a court in Manchester and put a citizen's arrest on this corrupt judge, and it stuck.
Yes.
So
we've had things
are happening.
There are. Recently in Australia, there's an area in Victoria called Lake Tyres, and the Aboriginal women there have had all sorts of problems with the administration, because these administrators have a Christian education, so therefore they have an entirely different philosophy, and they have an entirely different excuse system, and they suffer the problem that they can't see the crimes. They recently made an attempt towards autonomy on the basis that they're a sovereign people and they're on freehold land. I'm not too sure how far it's gone, but the government moved against them very quickly. They withdrew services as quickly as they could. And I think it's become a bit of a standoff. One of the problems might be that a lack of knowledge of sovereignty and what can be achieved with it is there, and I think that's an area that needs education, particularly for survivors of religious abuse. Does anybody have any thoughts on that aspect? Has anybody looked into the area of sovereignty?
It's a big one.
I know Kevin's always, he's declared himself a republic, hasn't he?
Okay.
Yeah, a citizen of the Republic of Kanata, which divorces itself from the British North America Act and the fact that the Queen and the Governor General are still the titular heads of state in that country.
Right. Common law, Cornelius is just making a point in chat there. I wonder, Cornelius, can you kick in on Skype with us? Because I think Cornelius has a bit of an understanding or a better understanding of this aspect than I do. But it's an area where survivors actually get their rights from. Most survivors fall to the issue of being entrapped back through the system. And those systems have been, as I said, set up to benefit and aid and support the church through these so-called survivor groups and networks that have arisen, most of which are just an avenue for obtaining funding to keep the administrators in a good wage. Few of them actually can provide real support. Still come back to that thing that few of these organizations can actually define what healing is. And most of them think that healing is to return back to the Catholic Church.
Yeah.
Okay.
And John, remember they told us we were crazy 2 years ago, you and I? We can't get anybody to say it anymore.
Yeah.
Nobody, I can't even, John, nobody will call me crazy anymore. What's up with that? I'd say John's one of the sanest people I know in the world.
Well, gentlemen, we have about 18 minutes left of the show, and Bill has some things that he needs to go over. So we're going to wrap it up at this point. Is there anything else y'all wanted to add before we wrap it up?
You want to hear the Olive Gardens thing?
Yes, we do.
If we've got
you mean they have a commercial?
Here it is.
If we've got
can't hear it.
Not coming through well, Ken.
Yeah, no, it's not coming through. Nah,
okay, we'll forget about it. Can you hear it now?
You'll have to do a video of it, though.
Basically, you like, apologize, Ken.
I'll do a video of it.
I hated the Olive Garden before you started. Now I like them.
All right.
Well, see,
anything else you gentlemen would like to add before we wrap it up?
I thought the manager at Olive Garden was sexually attracted to me and wanted me to just take my shirt off.
I still say you should have said no shirts, no service.
Correct. She looked like an ex-nun who was sex-starved.
Wow.
Which most clergy, they're all sex starved free. They need to get sex going.
I'm going to post into the chat there a link into our Facebook location, which is the GCAC. And anybody who wants to get involved in being genuinely proactive in opposing these people, then make contact with us, because together we can pull them up and force them to show their hand, make them act publicly.
Exactly.
And it's very, very powerful. For survivors, it's the greatest juice you'll ever drink, is to have these bikers stand down and back down.
The molested Catholics have a lot more power than they think they have. They just need to exercise the power.
They need to know their rights.
They are right.
Yes.
Well, we've got friends in Ireland who are Catholics and intend to continue to be Catholics. but they are just as adamant as you guys are for changing the whole atrocity of the Vatican and this huge international corporation that has bamboozled every government in the world for 500 years.
Yes, and it's time to call those governments to account, because they now become complicit. Because the evidence, as we all know, is there for all to see. And it now becomes very, very obvious that our governments are tainted and polluted, and our society, our whole social systems, have been tainted and polluted by it. It's maintained through taxpayers' funds to continue Catholic education systems, which simply renews and keeps the same thing alive. So, yes, it's no... People have got to get past the fact that the church is going to change its mind, and
right.
and the few bad apples are going to be found. That's not going to happen. It hasn't happened. The church has failed on every attempt to deal with this issue.
My goal is to organize. We fly to Italy. We just walk into Vatican, about 5 to 1,000 of us, and we just sit there and take over the offices. What are they going to do? It's all going to be on the Internet. The police can't do a thing about it. We just take over Vatican. And that's a dream I have.
Look out for those Swiss guards. They have those halberds and axes and things. They can stick them up your...
Well, they probably do that when the doors are closed at night. But my goal
Did you guys hear what Kevin did at the Vatican about a year ago, April? He held an exorcism right in St. Peter's Square.
What did he do?
And 12 hours later, there was a tornado hit central Rome and devastated the Vatican.
All right, well, we have about 13 minutes, Bill, and I want you to definitely read that letter. So,
yeah, I wouldn't mind.
Thank you so much for coming on. Go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah, it's been good, and I hope we can keep in touch, you know.
Kevin would be perfect speaker at University of San Diego, and we get John over there and get you two guys
good.
Talking at that Roman Catholic campus.
We're looking at September, October.
Great. Because it's got to come that survivors get to talk openly about the abuses and the denial of support from just the Catholic Church, but Catholics individually and in general, their organizations.
If the president of the campus asks the students to write a report paper on that meeting, they get extra credit towards their degree.
Yes.
Good.
So now it's documented by young students who want to hear about this stuff.
Great.
As I say, in contradistinction to Notre Dame.
Yeah.
Anyway, Nell wants me to read this letter, and I hope you two guys will hang in there. It's a little bit off topic as far as what we've been talking about with, you know, the emphasis on the Catholic Church. But Kev recently, he did this European tour, and he ended up in Montreal, and he's doing a bit of a gig around Ontario and Quebec, and then back across Canada. In the process, he spoke at to the Mohawk Nation at Kananaque, and in response, they sent him a letter of appreciation in the spirit of the two-row wampum peace treaty, mm-hmm. which refers to the original treaties that the Mohawk Nation made with all of the European invaders, going back to the Dutch in 16. Anyway, mm-hmm. I'll just read this letter, but I won't try to My knowledge of the pronunciation of Mohawk words is so inadequate, I'll just sort of
yeah.
give you the English.
You're going to do better than us.
I posted the link as well.
As a woman of the Five Nations Confederacy, I recognize that you, Kevin Annett, Eagle, who has a strong voice, carry the spirit of the mighty Eagle, whose duty to warn the people of any impending danger or irregularity. So long as you shall walk the land with your only allegiance to truth and righteousness on the path to return the original power to the two-row wampum peace treaty, created to reestablish balance on our Mother Earth, as this is the truth that is found in the natural world, are welcome to utilize our official symbolism in your efforts to restore humanity. Now, they gave him a wampum belt and this letter entitled the Two-Row Treaty. And this wampum belt depicts two rows symbolizing two nations, two cultures,
yes,
living side by side in harmony and truth. Now, this is what the native people understood as being the reality right back to 1616.
Uh-huh.
The white men interpreted this as a license to steal.
Yes.
The Indians actually offered to share the bloody continent of North America.
Yep. Yep.
And the white culture chose to, I mean, the most blatant thing about this is,
yes,
if you consider the oldest gag in North America is this thing, this joke about how the Dutch bought Manhattan for $24 worth of trinkets.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And we have always thought the joke is on them because, as Donald Trump would say, Manhattan, for Christ's sake, is worth trillions of dollars, and we got it for $24. But
yep,
the joke has really been on us because the Manhattan Indians didn't take that $24 as a purchase. They considered
right
it to be a gesture of friendship and respect.
Yes.
Yeah.
And they
yes
knew that you can't buy land because Mother Earth is not ours to own,
mm-hmm,
but to hold in stewardship.
That's
for
right
our children and grandchildren. And they offered to share it with us.
Mm-hmm. I think
and giving
find
Kevin
story
this great honor, the Mohawk Nation is asking him to continue their tradition, not ours. They ask
right
him to speak as a voice for two nations who all along should have lived side by side, as symbolized by the two rows on the wampum belt.
Okay.
Now, if we look at Manhattan today, we can see what we've done with that treaty, and
yes
it just makes you sick. And that's why I consider this the greatest honor that Kevin has ever been accorded.
Yes, it's an amazing honor. It is an amazing honor.
I should say, over the last 4 years, I've worked with a group of people trying to get Kev a nomination for the Nobel Peace Prize. I
yep
no longer give a tiddly damn if he ever gets the Nobel Prize. I don't care if he is ever given an Order of Canada. In fact, if he was, it would be an insult to everything he's tried to do for 20 years, and I'd recommend to him, although it wouldn't be necessary, to tell
yes
him where to put it, you know,
that's,
the Governor
yes
General and the absentee queen.
Yes.
I think this is a tremendous honor that he's been given, and I'm awfully proud of it.
And we're here backing him up, move it all forward.
I am proud of him. I find what he is doing is amazing, and it's genuine, and it does speak from a person's heart. It speaks about people as individuals, and their needs.
I find it amazing that you two guys, I don't know how you got together, but you're the perfect complement in the States and in Australia. What Kevin's been banging his head against the wall in Canada
yes
for 20 years
yes
about.
Yes.
And I hope we can all get together.
I think there's a reason,
Bill, there's a reason this is happening.
I think so.
I love it.
Yes. that has to happen, Bill, that we do come together. As I say, it's not going to progress until we do. And this issue of whether I believe as you believe has really got nothing to do with it. This is the tool that's been used to separate people and separate very clearly those people who want to speak out against the atrocity. So it's that's a smokescreen in itself.
Well, the other big news item today, I don't know whether you've seen it, John, but Ken probably has. It broke in Seattle on King 5 in Seattle, which is one of their major television stations. And that is this major settlement that's been announced in a massive lawsuit against the Jesuits.
Yep.
$116 million.
Yep.
Yes.
So things are happening.
Our efforts are making forward movement as we move the war line to Vatican. That's the prize for this war, Vatican. General Patton, we're going to finish what General Patton started.
There's another interesting aspect to that, and that's the recent case in the United States where the possibility that out-of-country crimes can be heard in an American court.
Right.
And we're currently investigating that down that line. So we'd certainly like to hear from people who've got some knowledge and experience in that area to help us out, because if we can get a platform, that's what we're lacking. We don't lack evidence. We don't lack witnesses. We lack a platform.
The precedent is there. That you can be sued by a group. And that's really what's behind Kev's organization of this international tribunal. On a de jure basis, that you can actually... 2 days ago, he served a summons to the Prime Minister's office on Stephen Harper in Ottawa. And whether or not he answers, that has been made, and it is... common law fact that if a country does not prosecute criminals, then the people can and should do it.
That's right. And that same applies here in Australia. And that's why I say this issue has to be taken up here in Australia, because that's the most powerful thing. It forces the government to address the issues. And that's going to be what's needed, and only when they come together with that as a common goal.
And John made a good point a few weeks ago. He says the government has to make a yes or a no stand against what's wrong. They have to give an answer. They can't say, we'll get back to you. They got to say yes or no.
That was in the context of Kevin's summons to the Prime Minister. It said, if you don't respond in 30 days, We assume that you are acknowledging that this is the case, and you are then open to common law arrest for crimes against humanity.
You're correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Well, now we have 1 minute, but we're going to finish up talking, so people will be able to hear it in the archive, the rest of it.
Go ahead, John.
Okay. I'd like to see make contact with Australians who... would like to get behind something just like that here in Australia.
Yeah, that's what I'm working on, the Forgotten Australians, the Child Migrants, and the Stolen Generation.
Yes, Lost Innocence. Yes, definitely.
So
that's where I'd like to go.
And hopefully we'll have more of them on the show as well, and start keep connecting everyone.
And hey, John, we did the radio show a year ago. This one's even, this one's really cool compared to the one last year we got fired to. We got people fired over last year.
Okay, I hope we've been helpful to everybody, and I hope they haven't
been very helpful.
we're different, but we're effective.
Healing is so much fun.
It is.
It really is.
Them all.
Oh, you guys.
Thanks for having us on, Bill.
Thanks for having us, and proud to work with everybody.
Yes.
Oh, we're proud to work with you as well. Y'all keep fighting, but somehow I think you will.
healing and fighting are fun.
Yes, keep that healing going. And don't forget to use all the church's resources in healing.
Yeah. Well, the Pope told us to do so.
Well, yeah,
yep.
There you go then.
Play the excellent music now.
Huh?
Oh. Sorry to mess up show now. We said that it was going to be here, there, and everywhere, didn't we?
Oh, we love it. That's fine. Okay, so Bill, did you have anything else you wanted to say before I play the end song?
Nope.
All right, gentlemen, thank you very much, and keep doing what you do.
Thanks
for having us.
You're welcome. The end song is Hell is for Children by Pat Benatar. I wonder who suggested that. Good night, everyone.
Bye.